I like to sleep here, then. Of course. She waves toward an empty tent. I'll bring you some food shortly, and I'll tell you some stories if you like. Enjoy your night. Look at how much money we have. Over 2,000 shins. We get to keep all of it. Nice.
Perfect.
Pretty much. Nice, yeah. That's awesome. Let's take a look at this thing. Yeah, I can't use it for anything. Okay, back to, let me just check him again.
I'll remember that.
You spoke earlier of the Abhuman's translator. We have examined it ourselves and determined it to be suitable. Your information was key to our acquisition and successful recruitment. We are pleased to provide this reward. It hands you a packet of shins. We are also pleased to report that we have undergone a successful decontamination upon our departure from the Murden Nest. Okay, good.
Making a note.
Dolk? Your assistance in this matter has been invaluable. We have reached our necessary quota far faster than we had any reason to believe. Because of this, we will not be needing this device any longer. It hands you a weapon. We just got 1,000 shins, oh my god. It hands you a weapon and then gives you another roll of shins. This will only slow us. It is yours now. 40 XP and 1,000, holy crap. We need all new armor. And weapons. A dolk. It's a cipher. Target is one enemy. Slices an enemy for 40 relativistic damage and confers dolk, which is minus 5 armor, minus 3 resistance, minus 45% evasion. Active entire crisis. A smooth spike of gray stone with leather wrappings at one end that make a simple handle. Its texture is as smooth as ice, and your finger leaves noticeable streaks as it passes over the permeable stone. Your digit tingles after touching it. The fragile dolk breaks and dissolves inside victims, becoming an effective poison. Nice. The construct strikes its hand across the front of its armor. Cool. And a row of buttons extrudes from its synth shell. Its fingers dance rapidly upon these buttons, and you are momentarily blinded by a flash of light. When you can see again, it is gone, leaving no trace of its presence. Well, that was interesting. Okay. So, to go in the maw. We still have to find this frame. I kind of want to do that before I sign off. Report back to Brusca. We're going to do that now. I should look for a maw that leads there. You know, all I have to do is look at the map. And that's where it is. It says, to Lost Anchorage. Infestation, yeah, soon. Bring the helmet to its owner's people. The Anchorage, Lost Anchorage, okay, everything leads there. Tiber. Tiber sense that Orving might be in Little Nylish, but I don't see... I didn't see Orving there. Alright, let's talk to Brusca then. Did I miss Orving somehow? Hmm. I found one of your patrols in Little Nylish. They were about to be killed by some angry mutants. That was you? They told me what happened. You have my thanks and theirs. Here, the men agreed you deserve something. 140 shins! My god, we have almost 3,500 shins. That's insane.
Making a note.
That's both my patrols you rescued. I don't know what we did to earn your help, but I'm truly grateful. I guess with those headaches out of the way, I can focus on more important matters now. She adds under her breath, important to some, anyway. She thinks, the Memovira is so afraid of her own skin that she's willing to let men die just to keep me close. You said you had other important matters to focus on? Well, it's not really your business, but But then, neither were my patrols, and I owe you that much. She shifts her weight and looks sidelong at the fortress door. The Memovira, you've probably heard she doesn't leave her fortress anymore. Well, that's because of the way the Bloom's been acting lately, and I think I know what the Bloom's behavior means. She thinks she should leave is what it means, but she's too damn proud for that. What does the Bloom's behavior mean? She lowers her voice. Do you know how the Memovira came to power? They say the Bloom helped her, that turned against the old Memovira and destroyed him. I was a kid, just a green mercenary at the time, but I remember the way the Bloom changed. The old Memovira could, well, not control the Bloom, I don't think anyone can do that, but sort of coax the Bloom to do what he wanted. Then one day the Bloom just stopped responding. Maws closed or reopened in horrible places, and a few weeks later the old Memovira was gone. She adjusts her chin toward the gate. The Memovira sees the similarities too and doesn't want that to happen to her, so she's shutting the Bloom out. She doesn't know what to do. She thinks, I'm worried there's nothing she can do, and what'll happen to the rest of us then? Well, isn't that part of the Bloom? Can't you open a maw there? Couldn't the Bloom open a maw there and get her? It's the same thing that happened just before the Memovira took power, when the old Memovira disappeared. You said the old Memovira just disappeared? They see the Bloom ate him, but I think it's worse than that. Her voice drops to a whisper. I've seen him, late at night sometimes, on the dark corners of the Bloom, an old ghost in rags and a long beard. Maybe I'm crazy, or maybe he isn't really dead. She shudders. Either way, I don't want to know. She thinks, I know what I saw. The Bloom didn't eat him like we thought. Not all of him, anyway. They say he was eaten, but I think it's worse than that. I've seen his ghost roaming the Bloom, old and ragged, with a long, tangled beard. The Memovira doesn't ever leave the fortress? Never. Not for months. She's afraid of the Bloom, of what it might do to her. She thinks the closing and shifting of the maws is a message. A warning. Based on the way it's been acting, yeah. So I think we have to look here again. And little Nyliash. Maybe we need to talk to him. Maybe Orving isn't there after all. And the empty cage. I hope it's not something like Allegra needs to be with me while we look for it.
Yes, lass.
He's still in little Nyliash, she says. Alright, so I missed something back there. Two things outstanding.
All right.
This guy Gristler sell things. Remember. I think he's not selling anything till he gets to a trading post or something. You know, I should save all this money for the trading post, actually. Oh, yeah? Show him the transdimensional scalpel. Have you ever seen a weapon like this? Gustav's eyes widen when he spies the scalpel and he waves it away. Get rid of it! He hisses. Can't you hear how much he hates it? He holds his hands to his ears as if in pain. You don't actually hear anything, but you assume he must be referring to the voices of the Bloom, or he's completely insane. I've heard of a weapon like that, he whispers, eyes still locked on the scalpel. Stories, mostly. It's been around the Bloom for a long time. That knife can cut open her maws if you fix it upright. She don't like it, and she's no friend to the one who wields it. Hmm. Hope I didn't get in trouble. Yeah, with that. I think this side is a little slave block, yeah.
Of course.
How sturdy is that really? Am I walking across bone? I mean, what is that?
Let's go.
Gotta find this frame. That's hard to find. Just close the door.
Of course.
Where are you? Let's ask Scora. If we can. No. Unless it's through that maw. Treasure trove. Yeah, let's go there. Treasure trove. It might just be a little treasure room.
Yes.
That might be where the frame is. That would be hard to get to, actually. It's literally just a little room with a treasure trove. Murdens treasure vault. Cool. Look, we don't have enough money yet, you know. Brightly colored bits and bobs form a small pile here, all of it completely worthless.
All right.
Not all of it. Black metal frame. Nice. 61 shins. Soul of the Forgotten. This casket is all the remains of a forgotten people who once lived and prospered in the Ninth World. Their names are etched into the lid in markings that resemble no known language. While beautifully engraved on the outside, the casket is minimalist, even bare on the inside. A single pastille lies within, containing the essence of those who created it. And this. This metal frame is about as tall as a human, and perhaps twice as wide. Rivets hide cleverly constructed joints, and the entire structure can collapse to the size of your forearm. Sweet.
I'll remember that.
You do that. Now that I have the frame, I should return it to Orthfong and Chirurgeon Slump.
Let's go.
52 shins, a heart of Mali, and a Canarads. Huh. Cipher. Confers Heart of Mali. Counters negative effects, excluding flanked and lasting damage. Applied to this character and heals a point of might, speed, and intellect per turn. Active 5 rounds. This pendant is composed of lead, set with a heart-shaped indentation filled with a green liquid. No matter how you turn the object, the acidic-smelling solution does not tip out. The liquid seems to gently slosh as if it had a will of its own. When placed against skin, the metal grows warm and sizzles gently until it becomes fused, though it causes no damage. It can easily be peeled off without leaving more than a mild blister. While bonded with the pendant, the wearer feels a sensation of contentment, tinged with childlike wonder and confusion at the shape and nature of the world. The item seems to hold some manner of charge, one that slowly builds through the tick and time and ages. Tick of time and ages. And this thing, Canarads, this strange device resembles a heavy cinder block with a protruding lens that retracts and extends. It releases a brilliant flash of light whenever the button on the side is pressed, and strange images form on the block's cracked crystalline panel.
I'm carrying too many ciphers.
Yes, I am. Sorry, Calistines.
Close to harm.
I'm sorry, I have too many. Probably sell some soon. I could interact with that.
All right.
I could loot this. A compass of the Navigator. This synth device appears to be a compass of some sorts. Runes and eye-twisting markings lining its edges. The compass arrow swings in seemingly random directions as if they were trying to steer you. Feather cloak. 2 armor, 3 resistance. Plus 20% movement speed, only usable by the last cast-off. This cloak is made of solid gold feathers held together by an unknown force. Whatever causes them to adhere to one another also keeps the weight from your shoulders, as it is surprisingly light to wear. When struck, the feathers stiffen, offering protection to the wearer. Awesome. When the wind blows through the cloak in a certain way, the feathers rustle together, the soft tingling reminiscent of a child singing. Huh. This is something I'd love to actually have in real life. So, yeah, we can't use that. We can't use that. Oh, yeah. What happens if I use this? You're holding a small box in your hands. It is shaped like a casket and beautifully ornamented, with writing etched into the lid in markings that resemble no language you know of. By contrast, the casket is minimalist, even bare on the inside. A single pastille lies within. Sorry guys, I think I just read the whole description over again. Inspect the markings on the lid. A skillful hand etched these markings deep into the lid. The glyphs are intricate and strike you as ideogrammatic, but you can't decipher them, and yet they seem oddly familiar, as if you've seen them before. If not in this life, then in another. The intricate glyphs are still nonsensical, but the longer you look at them, the more you have the sense you've seen them before. Anamnesis. Try to remember where you've seen these glyphs before. 95%. A memory blossoms, but it's hard to comprehend what you're seeing, as if it is seen through the eyes of someone not human. Do you speak this language, or do you not? You see your fingers trace a pattern on a set of glyphs, very similar to those on the casket's lid. Almost reflexively, you repeat the pattern on the lid. The casket lid opens, revealing that a small blue figure with long spindly limbs has now appeared, lying atop the pastille, opening some of its many eyes to look up at you. What? A small blue figure. The figure clambers up to sit on the edge of the casket. Several eyes are focused on you, blinking at irregular intervals. He starts speaking in a high, wailing tone. You can't understand a word he is saying. Recognizing this fact, he picks up the pastille and reaches it up toward you. I don't even know what that is. What's a pastille? Eat it? As you consume the pastille, a burning smell immediately overwhelms all of your senses. Flashes of memories try to force their way into your mind, but they are too alien to understand. After some time, your mind settles down, leaving blurry memories and hazy details, yet somehow you have gained a full recognizance of the people that this casket memorializes.
I'm ready to become even more heroic!
You understand that the people memorialized by this cask were a secluded people, now long gone, eradicated by a cataclysmic event. You feel the nature of their existence as if it were a tangible being. As they neared starvation, there was no crime, no theft. People sacrificed themselves before they would let others die. While you do not know them, you will remember them. As your cognizance ends, you find the creature gone, the casket now burning, with a cold fire in your hands. In mere moments, it is nothing but ashes, drifting away between your fingers. Did I gain something besides experience from this? I don't know. But Tiber can level up. I mean, up Tiber, Eretus. Oh, Keller's Cheese is so close. 9 points. Extra effort, yes.
Stories will be told of this day.
The day that Eretus gained extra effort. That's cool. Skeletal remains of a human lie amidst the treasure, clad in shiny armor. Unfortunately, the armor is purely ornamental. However, this is not. Make sure. Yeah, I didn't gain another cipher. Okay.
I'm going.
56 shins, a floating pendant, and an astronomical mirror caster. Another mirror caster. Take all. There's the mirror caster. Where'd the other thing go? A pendant, right? It said? Here it is. Floating pendant. Pendant. Looks like a dinosaur, kind of. Held by an invisible chain, this pendant is in the shape of a tiny simplified brem. Mm-hmm. The hell that is. Some kind of reptile creature. It has no apparent weight when held or worn. The invisible chain snaps itself around the wearer's neck when the pendant is held to the chest. Cool. Can't do anything with that, but... Filled with ingenious clockwork mechanisms, this kobold orrery depicts a solar system far different from your own. The tiny planets orbit and rotate soundlessly and endlessly, the pattern of their paths no doubt revealing alien destinies and prodigies to be puzzled over by learned beings in some distant unknown place. Here it is merely a novelty, though one that invites contemplation. I'm afraid to even use this thing, because it's getting, like, late for me. This immense pile is comprised of shiny baubles, decorative objects, and broken bits of Numenera. Most of the treasure has no practical value whatsoever. Alright, so these three things, and then we can interact with this stuff. Whatever the hell. Looks like a Rubik's Cube with all the labels peeled off, which was then hit by some kind of blade. Double-edged blade or something.
Fine.
Tucked away in this fleshy abscess is a sculpture of a pickaxe. Right, a pickaxe, that's what I meant. Embedded in a jumble of stone blocks. Near the sculptor's base is a bronze plaque. Examine the plaque. Etched on the plaque is a short message. Better to swing the pick than strike the vein. Shins or shackles and treasures chains. Tiber chuckles long and low. Spoken like someone who dislikes their money and shackles. I don't think the artist and I would have got along. Examine the pickaxe. The shining metal handle towers overhead, completely out of reach. You couldn't touch it without climbing the sculpture itself, and even then, it looks far too heavy to move. The pickaxe trembles, and you blink. You felt the motion in your mind. You may actually be able to affect this sculpture with your thoughts. Try to free the pickaxe. 95%. Success! You focus on the handle of the pickaxe and think, move. It twitches, but nothing else happens. Shutting out every sound around you, every tremor in the floor, and the soft thumping of your heart, you pit your full attention against the shape of the tool above you. With a hoarse scraping sound, the pickaxe retracts from the stone blocks, and a waterfall of shins cascades from some inner recess in the sculpture into a pile between the blocks. Cool. You won a battle of wits with a sculpture! Eretus gasps. Congratulations! And the paragons and stuff inside of Eretus thinks, the hero should have solved that challenge. You feel cheated. Take take the shins. As you reach out for the shins inside the sculpture, a strange feeling of revulsion sweeps over you. Really? Take them anyway? Red tide and silver tide raised a moderate amount. You quickly scoop up the shins. With each handful, the queasiness seemed to sink deeper into you, fogging your thoughts. Gain 180 shins. Regain demoralized fettle until we sleep again. That's alright. Demoralized. Minus 20% willpower, minus 10% evasion, and minus 15% on all tasks. Yeah, we'll go sleep. We can sleep for free now, damn it.
Yes.
It might be your imagination, but the luster of the plaque at the base of the sculpture seems to have dimmed since you saw it last. Alright, so there's nothing else.
All right.
So that's one more. We have two more. We have to the... whatchamacallit?
Don't mind if I do.
The lost, crap, what is it? The lost anchorage. And to the old trading post.
Go. Yes.
So now we return to Chirgin Slump. And I need to summon Allegorn.
Let's go.
Let's do it. We need to talk to this guy.
Well then, farewell. For now. You won't be gone long.
Algern.
Ready to test this out.
Hail. Hail you, Orthfong. Algern, his smile does not include you. I hope that all progresses well. Why did you come to the bloom? I did not ask this. I studied that frame for years. Years. The more I studied it, the more concerned I was about the effects that I might trigger if I were to activate it somehow. With Allegrin's village of Ormin as my first data point, I thought perhaps I should remove myself to some place where the effects might be less disastrous. He gestures to the space around him. Much safer here, much less likely to disrupt anything important. Also, the Order of Truth was annoyed with me. Is this the frame you were looking for? One quick glance at it is apparently all he needs. He yelps with delight, takes it from your hands, and strokes the joints on the collapsed frame. He studies it carefully. It doesn't appear that the Murdens have damaged it extensively. It still seems to have that constant low hum of power, and... yes. Yes, this will do nicely. He hands you a bag with an impressive amount of shins inside. 250 shins, look at all that. And spend this at the old training post.
I need to talk to you.
He grabs Allegrin's forearm. Pull one of these halfway out, Allie. Allie. He keeps his other eye trained on the frame. As Allegrin lifts a tattoo, hissing and buzzing from his skin, Orth leans forward, licking his lips. Yes. He whispers. Yes. Yes. He grabs Allegrin and kisses his friend full on the mouth. My friend, I forbid you to use your tattoos anymore, unless... He pauses, clearly building for dramatic effect, Unless you enjoy throwing your family and friends. He beams. Throwing? Allegrin's mouth hangs slightly open, and there's a sunken look to his eyes. He thinks, my family? This throwing? I don't know what he means. The smile slowly disappears from Orthfong's face. I thought this might be happier news for you, Allegrin. Do you understand what I'm saying? What are you saying? I'm saying that all this time, Allegrin, you've been carrying around your family and friends. They have been transmuted into energy and transplanted onto your forearms. Those creatures you saw, nothing more than a visual representation of the deconstruction process. Your family wasn't devoured, Allegrin. They are alive. Orth, are you saying that I've been using my family and friends as weapons? I've been stealing their power to defend myself? Have I damaged them? He grabs Fong's arm and rasps, how do I restore them to humanity? He thinks, how many times have I used them? Why did I never count? Never think? Well, yes. You have been using them like that, which is why I suggested you take special care with them. But they might not have suffered ill effects. I cannot say for sure. All you need to do is reactivate the frame, and they will be restored to you. He scuffs the ground with his foot and mutters, we can evaluate their progress then. Allegrin snatches the frame from Oth and snaps it out to its full expanse. He runs his fingers along the sides, his agitation increasing by the moment. Why is this not working? Orth, why isn't this working? Perhaps it requires a special activation sequence, Allegrin. Is that true, Orth? Could that be it? Allegrin's opinion of you has improved. Blue tide, small amount as well. Perhaps, yes. If this device functions as a matter decoherence and imprinting transfer, it would necessarily require a passcode of some sort to unlock it. It wouldn't do the ancient users any good if they accidentally recorporealized their passengers, would it? It would require an act of intentionality. He taps his lips thoughtfully. So, do you happen to know any extremely powerful psychics? Someone stronger than a mere mind reader? One of them might know how to unlock this code from your mind, but I am no student of the psionic arts, my friend. I have done for you what I can, and frankly, I think my efforts have been sufficient. What about Delny? Allegrin considers. I might know just the person. She's back in Sega's Cliffs. Once we're out of the bloom and I'm done with this cast-off business, I'll go find her. He wraps his arms around Fong in a sudden embrace, and his voice is husky. I am forever in your debt. You have been sufficient, and more than sufficient, you have been heroic. I will. He thinks, stronger than a mind reader, eh? Gods, I hope she's still living there. Fong waves an embarrassed hand. You gave me a puzzle, Allegrin. It was a delight. He frowns a little. Though if you could explain to Min just how helpful I've been, and tell him how I unlocked the secret none of them could, that would go a long way toward clearing this debt you mentioned. He fakes a cough, as if unused to displaying emotion. Well, my work is finished. I really must return to my position in the Order. Farewell.
I'll remember that.
At any rate, I hope they kept my desk clear. Cool. So he definitely wants to talk to us. Quest complete.
What do you need?
It's you. You wish to talk to me. I never saw this in front of that portrait. That must be new.
I don't know how to thank you for your help with the frame, with the tattoos, with my family. I know I haven't been the easiest companion, or the most trusting. I hope now you know why I behaved as I did.
I guess so. For the first time, the pain in Allegrin's eyes is gone. The tight lines that surround his mouth have loosened, and something that looks almost like hope struggles to creep into his expression. I love what the little lines of dialogue. I wish there was more. Seriously, they're having each actor do five lines or something like that. Besides other than what do you need or let's go or something. I wish we'd known sooner. I'd have stopped using the tattoos. If my family, my friends are damaged, he swallows. I guess we'll see what happens. How are you holding up? I'm fine. Appreciate you asking. Alright, let's see. There's that part that sounds like Torment. So Allegern reveres me as well. Eric just likes me. Tyrebear likes me. Yay. Six points. Huh. Well, I can level up. Stat pools. You think I have enough intellect? How about speed? I seem to use that quite a bit as well.
I've learned something new.
Excellent. I don't know what it is, but concentration increase, maybe? We already had that. Event Horizon? No. I don't know what I learned. Very sorry.